Around 400 million years ago, there were some major evolutionary changes to aquatic life that made life on land possible. And in this video, we're going to be talking about life during the Middle Paleozoic era. In terms of the timeline for the Middle Paleozoic, this is generally considered the Silurian and the Devonian periods of the Paleozoic era. So the Paleozoic era as a whole went from around 542 million years ago at the beginning of the Cambrian period to around 250 million years ago at the end of the Permian, but the Middle Paleozoic is the Silurian and Devonian periods, which went from around 444 million years ago to around 359 million years ago. At the end of the Ordovician period, just before the Silurian period, there was a major mass extinction event, the first of the big five mass extinctions throughout the Phanerozoic eon. And life in the Silurian and Devonian rediversified quite drastically after that extinction event. In fact, their recovery surpassed the radiation that occurred in the Ordovician period. There were more advanced reef builders. There were more advanced swimming predators. There were vascular plants spreading throughout land rather than just non-vascular plants as they were in the Ordovician period. And even vertebrates began moving to land. This is us, guys. These are our ancestors. This is what allowed us to evolve. Although now that I think about it, maybe if we never came out of the sea, maybe we'd be like mermaids or something, which would be pretty cool. But anyway, this transition to land was pretty significant. But we are going to start with reefs. So in terms of the radiations or diversification that happened after the Ordovician extinctions in the Silurian period, they didn't drastically change the ecosystems. They just kind of refilled the empty niches that had been emptied by the extinction event. But reefs are one exception. Reefs diversified in many new ways rather than just kind of re-evolving the same way. And they did this by way of new reef builders, not even the same builders that were building the reefs in the Cambrian and Ordovician. Like I talked about in the early Paleozoic life video, the early Cambrian reefs were built by organisms called archaeocyathids, and these guys went extinct at the middle of the Cambrian. And then after that, reefs really didn't recover at all until the Ordovician period, just after the Cambrian. But they still weren't really at their peak until the Middle Paleozoic, where we had corals and stromatopteroids building much larger reefs. Coral strom reefs were large and successful in the Silurian period, but they reached enormous sizes in the Devonian, and they grew in characteristic successions that we can see in the fossil record that these reefs left behind. First, stick-like tabulate and rugose corals grew in the subtidal area. Then a low mound formed when these fragile stick-like corals were encrusted by colonial rugose and tabulate corals. Then stromatopteroids and algae also encrusted the structures on the seaward side of the mound, forming a durable ridge. And that ridge then blocked the water behind it to be a pretty quiet area where tabulate and colonial rugose corals then grew in that quieter area. And beyond the quiet area, tabulate and rugose corals was a calm lagoon where muds mostly accumulated as well as some debris from those reefs. But getting to, well, in my opinion, what's a little bit more interesting are the swimming predators of the mid-Paleozoic. So one of the greatest changes of the marine ecosystems at this time was the evolution of ammonoids, which were swimming predators that evolved from the nautiloids. You can see the straight-shelled nautiloids here and ammonoids in the bottom picture. Nautiloids were present before, obviously, because they evolved into the ammonoids, but they only persisted at low diversity through this time, whereas the ammonoids radiated rapidly during this time and kind of took over. And that's one of the reasons that ammonoids are such good index fossils, literally from like this time until the end of the Mesozoic, because they were so widespread and successful, and their species only lived for short periods of time. So they're very distinctive for certain intervals of time in Earth's history. And joining ammonoids and nautiloids as the top invertebrate predators of the time were the eurypterids. Eurypterids were basically sea scorpions. scorpions, and these sea scorpions got up to 8 feet or 2.5 meters in length. But it's important to note that the ones around during the mid-Paleozoic, the Silurian and the Devonian, weren't this large. They were much smaller, I think like a foot to 2 feet, but the large ones evolved in the later Paleozoic when oxygen rose in the Carboniferous, and I talk about that in a later video. But even if these guys were smaller in the mid-Paleozoic, I don't think that I would want to come across one. But invertebrates weren't the only predators in the mid-Paleozoic seas. That's right, we had vertebrates by this time. We had fish and we had large fish. In the Cambrian, there were fish, but the only fossils we have of these fish are fragments and they're not fully preserved very well, at least the ones we found so far. And these fish weren't super large or complex. It wasn't until the Silurian and Devonian, the mid-Paleozoic, where full fish fossils have been found preserved in both marine and freshwater deposits of this time. Most Silurian fish fossils come from freshwater deposits, but we know that fish first evolved in the ocean because all Cambrian and Ordovician fish fossils are in marine deposits, but we don't know whether this freshwater abundance of fish fossils in the Silurian represented a greater abundance of fish that migrated from marine to freshwaters, or if this greater abundance of freshwater deposit fish fossils is just due to better preservation. So I'll leave it at that. But now let's talk a little bit about the types of fish that were around in the mid-Paleozoic. These guys get real weird. One of the more conspicuous groups of fish that are preserved in the fossil record of this time is the Ostracoderms. Ostracoderms look kind of like what's in this picture, and here's a fossil of one up at top. And Ostracoderms were covered in body armor. In fact, their name literally means bony skin, but they actually lacked jaws. These were jawless fish. Jawed fish didn't evolve till later in the mid-Paleozoic, and we'll get to those. But these Ostracoderms differ greatly from modern fish in that they had small mouths for very small items of food, and they lacked internal bones. Their internal skeletons were actually cartilage rather than bone, and they lacked highly mobile fins, meaning they had less control over their movements, and they were probably mostly just deposit feeders that fed on small items of food at the seafloor rather than swimming around in the water column. They thrived until the end of the Devonian, so even when other larger, more mobile fish evolved, they still thrived. But then at the end of the Devonian, they and lots of other things went extinct because there was a major mass extinction. But that's, I talk about that in a different video. But what other types of fish were there? And when did jawed fish show up? Well, if you remember, I mentioned at the beginning of this video that life recovered greatly after the Ordovician extinction in the Silurian and Devonian. But one group of organisms that never fully recovered after the early Paleozoic was trilobites. And this was due to a specific type of predator that evolved in the mid-Paleozoic, that is the jawed fish. Jaws drastically changed the marine and even terrestrial ecosystems, and we'll get to how it even affected terrestrial ecosystems in a second. But in terms of the trilobite decline, they declined because their calcified, mineralized skeletons really no longer cut it, because when it came to jaws, it didn't really matter. They could still become crushed in, you know, strong enough jaws. I mean, here's a Devonian jawed fish just chomping down on a sea scorpion, I mean. But predation, even though it looks a little scary, isn't always bad. Actually, evolutionarily, it's one of the major driving factors for many, you know, adaptations in prey type animals like trilobites and other organisms that these guys were hunting. Those would have had to evolve adaptations or die. So this was one of the reasons that the evolution of jawed fish as predators was important, but we'll talk about later other reasons why they were majorly important. The earliest jawed fish were small and lived in both marine and fresh water, and they were called acanthidians. I'm going to go with that. I read these words more than I hear them. But these guys are shown in the picture to the right, and they had scales rather than bony plates like the Ostracoderms, and they had paired fins. But the most important feature they had, of course, was jaws. The evolution of jaws opened up the ability of vertebrates, fish in this case, to prey on animals as large as they were. But where exactly did jaws come from? I mean, what feature did they adapt from? Primitive Silurian fish jaws evolved from gill bars, or bars that supported the gills of early fish. We can see in the figure to the right the gill bars and then how those gill bar skeletal elements adapted themselves into folding into jaw bones, and eventually teeth evolved. Actually, we can see jaw evolution in the shark fossil record pretty well, the transition, and we can also see teeth evolution in this record as well. Shark skin has pointed structures called denticles that make their skin so rough, feel like sandpaper, and these were actually adapted into teeth. They were just enlarged in the skin over the ancestral gill bar or the primitive jaws to form teeth. And obviously, guys, remember that all of these adaptations are just random mutations, and it's just the fact that it was advantageous that it stuck and it, went down the line of evolution and became more and more dramatic if it was a beneficial feature, or, died out and didn't stick if it was a disadvantageous feature. But obviously, jaws and teeth were really advantageous. So, getting back to why jaws were so important, one of the reasons is that, again, it allowed fish to eat larger fish, and that added new levels to the food web. Now, very large fish could feed on smaller fish, and those fish on still smaller fish, and so on, until you get to like organic matter and bacteria and whatnot. But before this, like the Ostracoderms, many fish were just feeding on really tiny things like organic matter and like little tiny organisms and invertebrates at the sea floor. But now, obviously, fish could eat fish. At the top of this food chain in the Silurian and Devonian, the Devonian especially, were the Placoderms. Placoderms were heavily armored fish that evolved in the very, very late Silurian and dominated in the Devonian. They first actually evolved in freshwater and then migrated to the oceans in the mid-Devonian. And the largest of them was called, or at least the largest in the fossil record that we've found, is called Dunkleosteus. Stewis? Stew? Stews? You guys can read it. I'm not going to try and say it, because if I say it wrong, somebody's just going to get mad at me, and I don't want to say it wrong. So here is what the largest placoderm was, and it got up to 7 meters or 23 feet in length, which is pretty terrifying. But what about the fish that we find most terrifying in modern oceans? Sharks. Were they around then? Well, yes, they were around, but they were pretty primitive and small, especially compared to the giant placoderm fish. And here's a picture to the right where you see this one genus, Cladocephalicae, Celac, I don't know. But this genus was the Devonian shark that commonly was found with the giant placoderms in the rock record, and they were only like a few feet in length. Another type of fish evolving in the mid-Paleozoic were the ray-finned fish. These were also jawed fish that diversified in the Devonian, but they didn't really dominate until the Mesozoic and Cenozoic eras, which are way after the mid-Paleozoic and actually continue today. The Cenozoic is the era we're actually in. And that makes sense because ray-finned fish include many of the modern fish that we're most familiar with, like trout, bass, herring, and tuna. They're named ray-finned fish because their bones in their body kind of radiate out to their fins to support their fins. But even with all these different types of fish adapting and diversifying in the Devonian, the most significant adaptation or fish type or invention in the Devonian was lungs. Lungfish were very successful in the Devonian, but only three genera survive today. One type of lungfish in the Devonian, though, that's of particular interest was the lobe fin fish. Unlike in ray-finned fish with the radial organization of the bones in the fin, the lobe-finned fish had fin bones that connected to the body bones by a single shaft and then more bones in like the handish area. They lived in freshwater, marine water, and then eventually ventured into terrestrial environments. Yes, that is right. These guys, these lobe-finned fish, are our ancestors. Technically, the first animals to move to land were invertebrates like millipedes and insects, which happened in the late Silurian period, but vertebrates were not far behind. Vertebrates transitioned to land in the Devonian period, and lobe-finned fish which thankfully already had lungs, evolved into a transitional form called Tiktaalik, which is one of the transitional forms in between fish and amphibians. They're not fish and they're really not amphibians. They're a transition. And finding transitional forms like this in the fossil record is like the key for puzzling together evolution. And so Tiktaalik actually fits right in between lobe-fin fish and, you know, full primitive amphibians. So what exactly was Tiktaalik and how did it live? Well, it had fin bones to prop itself up at the water's margin and kind of like walk around in shallow water. It could even walk a little bit on land, but not great and not long distances. It even had eyes on top of its head, kind of like crocodile or alligator, to view surroundings with its head propped out of water. And it had nostrils too on the top so it could breathe when just the top of its head was out of water. And of course it had lungs already because it evolved from lungfish. By the mid-Devonian, trackways in the fossil record indicate the full transition from fish to early amphibian. These early amphibians, though, likely spent most of their time still in water, and this was to keep their skin moist when shade wasn't available because they had very sensitive skin. And it wasn't until trees and other large plants provided a lot of shade on land in the Devonian that allowed amphibians to spend more time on land in that shade. And in fact, that's the last major evolutionary thing we'll talk about in this video is plants. Plants underwent major transitions in the mid-Paleozoic. In the early Paleozoic, non-vascular plants did move to land in the Ordovician period, but it wasn't until the Devonian in the mid-Paleozoic that vascular land plants evolved. I talk more about this transition in my When Life Moved to Land video, which I'll link up to the top right if you want to check out. But to summarize, the first vascular plants to move to land in the Devonian were seedless, and so they couldn't really move past moist environments very far, but seed plants then soon followed after them, and those spread to drier areas, which basically allowed the covering of the entire land area in vegetation for the first time in Earth's history. This, like I just mentioned, helped amphibians move to land because it provided shade, but this also had drastic consequences because the way that vegetation covering all of land masses for the first time affected climate. And this caused the second of the big five mass extinctions in the Phanerozoic Eon, that is, the late Devonian mass extinction. But I talk about this and other mass extinctions in other videos, so you can check those out individually if you'd like. They'll pop up here on the screen any second now. You can also check out the playlist below, which should also pop up any second now. And to make that Earth History playlist, I typically use the Earth System History book, which I did use for this video, so it'll be linked down below, as well as any other minor and supporting references. And guys, if you want any extra or perk content or early release videos, you can press join down below to become a channel member and you can get those. But if you don't want to do that or you're not able to, I totally understand. You can still press the like button for absolutely $0 and I would greatly appreciate that. So thank you so much for watching and I will see you guys in the next video. Bye.